We acknowledge your presence, and we want to sing our hearts out to you right now, God. Amen. Officially awake. In our weakness we find peace. We trust a promise, deliverance is coming. And even as we suffer pain, your spirit's right beside to help us through the long wait for strength to come, a hope to carry on. Wait for you, Lord. Wait for you. All our hearts are crying for redemption. 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 sons and daughters ache for change. We look to be released alongside your creation. We feel your spirit deep within. Our broken bodies are crying out for answers. Leaving words behind. I long to see your eyes. Wait for you, Lord. Wait for you. All our hearts are crying for redemption. Redemption. All our hearts are crying for redemption. Redemption, yeah, all our hearts are crying for redemption, redemption, all our hearts are crying for redemption, redemption.
So hey, Psalm 23, have you heard of it? It's a good psalm, and we're going to read it together today, and then we're going to start memorizing it. Whoa! And we're going to memorize the whole thing. And I don't know if you really, I guess you have a choice about it. You can just sit there and not do it. But today, we're going to start with today reading the whole thing together. And next week, we're going to read the whole thing together, but the first verse won't be up on the screen. You're just going to have to know it in your brain, okay? Does that make sense? Then 2 weeks from now, the first two verses won't be on the screen. It'll be in your brain. All right? This is intense. But let's start today by reading it all together. Is it on the screen? Are we ready? You ready? All right. The Lord is my shepherd.
I lack nothing.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. All right, well done. So the first week's pretty easy because all it is like seven words. As we get further along, the fifth and sixth verses, that's just not very fair. But by that time, I feel fully confident that we're going to nail it. Sound good? All right, let's do one more song, okay?
Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning on the everlasting arms. My troubled soul, why so weighed down? You were not made to bear this heavy load. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord. Jesus cares, he cares for you. Jesus cares, he cares for you. And all your worrying won't help you make it through. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord. And trust again in the promise of his love. Now we'll praise the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord, the lifter of my head. Praise the rock of my salvation. All my days are in his faithful hands. Trials come, are you so easily forget to cast your burdens upon the Lord? Jesus cares, he cares for you. Yeah, Jesus cares, he cares for you. And all your worrying won't help you make it through. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord, and trust again in the promise of his love. And I will praise the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord, the lifter of my head. Praise the rock of my salvation. All my days are in his faithful hands. I will praise the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord, the lifter of my head. Praise my, oh my, salvation. All my days are in his faithful hands. Yeah, I will praise the mighty. Jesus, praise the Lord, the lifter of my head. Praise the rock of my salvation. All my days are in his faithful hands.
Amen. Well, hey, welcome again to the church. Give somebody a high five. Tell them it's going to warm up soon. Just kidding. And then go ahead and grab a seat.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good to see you. I'm Samantha Tidball. You can call me Sam. I'm the youth pastor here at the Vineyard. And I'm so excited. There's so much enthusiasm. I love it. 2017 is going to be a good year, right? Right? We're going to make it this year. We're going to be all right. All right. I'm excited. Feeling that. Feeling that love. Feeling that enthusiasm. It's going to be fantastic. Did y'all have a good weekend? Yeah, it's cold. I know, it's cold. Well, Friday, we just had a pretty awesome youth event here. We had some bouncy boxing. What is that? I don't know. It's an inflatable, and it was great fun. I know, there was some of this going on, lots of bouncing. It was pretty awesome. It was good times. If you missed it, it's okay. We'll have more events coming up, but make sure you like our Facebook page because that's how you'll also see, even if you're not in the youth group, still like the page because I post a lot of videos, and you may see some of our students doing some bouncy boxing or running up and down the stairs like Rocky, you know, some fun things like that. So make sure you check out our Facebook page. But anyway, that's my own little plug. But if it's the first time you're here, if you've always been here, either way, we want to welcome you and glad that you're here. You may have noticed that there's three cards in the seat in front of you. The first is our welcome card. And if you're new or you think you're new, or I just want to invite you to fill out the requested information on the card, just basically so that we can get to know you better and then extend a warmer welcome to you. You can put it in our offering bags that will be passed around later in the service, or if you bring it to our welcome station out front, you will receive a $5 Starbucks gift card, right? I know, that's pretty awesome. So make sure you definitely do that. Along with the welcome card, you'll notice a green giving card and a blue prayer card. The giving card provides information on how you can give to the church and includes a checkbox if you want more information on how you can support what we're doing here financially. And the prayer card is a way that you can write down your prayer requests and also your praises and things that you're grateful for. And on Wednesday, myself and the rest of the staff, we actually take time to pray about these requests individually. And if you'd like follow-up, make sure you put your name on it and you check the box, and we'll make sure that one of our staff will reach out to you and just check in, see how you're doing, and just let you know that we're there to pray for you. So I'm going to highlight a few more upcoming events here at the church. First of all, everyone's invited to join us for a movie night on Friday, January 20th. Yeah, see, look at this. You guys, 2017 is going to be awesome. I'm feeling it. It's going to be good. All right, so we'll have a big screen with a movie. We're going to watch Inside Out, okay? I don't care how old you are. That movie's awesome. You can learn a lot from it. So come. I'm going to go because there's popcorn and good stuff. So definitely come. Ask Mary Buzzard if you have more questions. Pastor Donnell is hosting a conversation on Saturday, January 21st, around leadership in both our local church and within our communities. So come connect with us from 10 to noon to explore how you can use your unique gifts and talents. I know that you have them. I know that you all are very talented. So come to that. Lunch is provided, but space is limited. So don't forget to sign up today, which you can do at our event station near the front doors. Meet other churchgoers, connect with leaders and stakeholders and the pastoral team at our monthly community coffee hour. Hang out with us after the service on January 15th in the gallery, and we'll have some sugary stuff and extra coffee on hand that you will enjoy. All right, David Palladino is launching a class in February to explore themes of discipleship in the Gospel of Mark. The class will meet at 9 a.m. on Sunday mornings, and childcare will be provided. More details will be coming soon, so keep an eye out on paper and electronic bulletins as well. But what a great opportunity to really grow and go deeper in your faith. So we're in need of more volunteers for our children's ministry program. Actually, our pastor Mary, our children's pastor, is supposed to be giving announcements this morning, but she couldn't because she's short-handed, once again, in the childcare area. So we need you people. We need help to take care of our little ones here at the church. And I'm telling you, though, when you step into those leadership roles to serve our children, I think you'll find how much the kids really bless you. And, you know, there's hard parts of it, too. I can say that because I'm a parent. But these kids are amazing, and you'll really experience God's love in a big way. So please step up and help to do that, because we just love to have you service in that way. And if you'd only like to do it once a month or you don't know how much you can commit, talk to Mary, and she can find a way just to plug you in times that work for you. So let Mary know. And last but not least, we serve a God who knows us by name, and we desire to be a community where we know the names of one another, which I think personally is a really unique and awesome thing about this church. So if you will, please take a name tag. You can find them in the front row of each section and pass them back, and put your name tag on so that we can actually get to know your name, because that is super important. And right now I want to invite Pastor Donnell up for a very special dedication.
On, and sometimes I press the button and it doesn't come on. But this time I've pressed the button and it's on, and I have two of my notebooks. So Andrew, can I give you, nope, this one I need. Can I give you that one? All right, we have the Fants and family up here. Hi, everybody. How are you all? It's so good to see you all. Let's see, we've got Jeff and Ainsley and Delia, who is going to get dedicated today, Jeff's mom. Susan is here, and then we've got Jeff's sister, Amy, and her husband, Jeff, and then the kids, and then Tom. All right, good. I'm just reading, so it's really hard to read, so just bear with me as I go through. So it's with a thankful heart and a joyous heart that we are here to dedicate your daughter to the Lord. We acknowledge that every human life is a gift from God, and we believe that children belong to God and are entrusted to us for just a season. It's a call for us to protect and to guide and to challenge and to gradually release these precious children, and it requires every resource that we have. And then Ainsley's family couldn't be with us this morning, so they sent flowers and so are represented on the stage with the beautiful life that's there. Okay, great. So Ainsley and Jeff, you have brought your precious daughter before this community of friends and family to dedicate her to the Lord and to dedicate yourselves to the task of parenting. Will you pledge and support and love her by providing an opportunity for her to grow up in a family of faith with the hope that she will someday know Jesus as her own teacher, Lord, and Savior? Will you, to the best of your ability and with God's help, provide a loving family environment so that she can grow in love, loyalty, and obedience to God? Will you encourage her to grow in faith so that she might be received into the fellowship of the church, fully partaking in the work and the worship of the church? And to the grandparents and aunts and uncles and cousins, blessed is the child who has a faithful, loving family. Will you also pledge to support and to encourage and love Delia and her parents through these wonder-filled and sometimes frustrating years to the best of your ability? All right, church. You have a responsibility in this as well. And look at the setup that we did for you, because Sam just came up and said, we need someone in the nursery. So now, You are called to ensure that no parent stands alone, that no child is without many aunts and uncles, brothers and sisters. And we're here to help them with this awesome responsibility of raising children. So are you willing to help by signing up and helping out in the nursery? Well, see, now you don't want to say yes. So you're just like, wait, this was all for them. Why are you talking to us? Well, because it takes a village, and so we do need some help there. So are you willing to help out?
Yeah.
All right, good. So those of you who definitely said yes, see Mary, and just sign up for a week. I think we had like 12 or 13. We've got the next like whole season done. All right, Delia, let's go ahead and dedicate you so I can get on with my sermon. You're ready. I get it. I'm sorry. Delia, you are now dedicated to the Lord in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I have a prayer for you. I pray that God will anoint you to restore what's broken in the world. I pray that God will allow you to embrace those who find themselves at the margins. I pray that God would bless you and envelop you with his loving presence. May you come to know that God is good. May you come to know that God is compassionate. May you come to know that God is full of grace and mercy, that God, the God that we serve, is slow to anger. May you come to know and represent the unfailing love that God has for us. And may the goodness of God overwhelm you, may it arrest you, and may it establish in your heart and mind an anchor on which you can weather any storm and any attack from our adversary. May all of the resources of home, family, and church nurture you and encourage you towards your own decision to follow Jesus through the narrow gate into life. Lord, we thank you for this precious child. We ask that you would bless her all the days of your life and give to her parents and family and church what we need to come alongside her as she grows and matures in faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. She was making like full-on eye contact. I do this a lot, and kids are all like, get off of me, move away. You're awesome. Yay. All right, guys, you can give her an applause. Good job.
If she wasn't hungry, she probably would have smiled.
Oh, no, she's doing great. Thanks, guys. No, you can leave them right where they are. I want to be reminded of them. Okay. Hi. It's been a weekend, so I'm glad that you made it. I made it. I don't know about you, but I made it this week. Before I go on, I need to do two things. One, I have to blow my nose. I'm sorry. It's when I get under these lights, I just have to blow my nose all of a sudden. So while I do that, get a sermon handout, get a Bible. We're going to be in the Old Testament and the New Testament today, so give me a second. I know, Andrew did it. Pete's helpful. Thank you, Pete. All right, so we are glad that you are here with us this morning. If this is your first time, your 100th time, or your 1,000th time, we are honored by your presence in the space this morning. Whether you arrived here this morning because of an internet search, because you were invited, because you listened to our podcast, or because you already knew the way, we are grateful for your presence and the gift of God that you bring into this space with you. We pray for you before each celebration that you would experience welcome, that you would experience acceptance, and that you would have a little bit of peace as you spend time with us this morning. We also pray that God would show up in a powerful way that you might have a transformative encounter with the living presence of the loving God. Before I launch into the sermon this morning, I just want to do a quick tithing interlude. Right before Thanksgiving, as we were wrapping up our Life in the Spirit sermon series, I did a sermon on learning to trust God with our treasure. And in that, I practically invited all of us to participate in the spiritual discipline of giving, either by making your first contribution or by creating a recurring giving account. And a quick update, so far we've had about 16 new givers. We need about 50 new givers who are giving $50 a month. That works out to about $12.50 a week. And we've had about 12 existing givers set up new recurring giving accounts. And so I just want to encourage us, because we're making steady progress. We only have 34 new givers to go. And if you give online, out in the lobby on the event station, we have these I Give Online cards so that you can participate in the offering as it comes along so you don't just pass the bag. And then if you give cash, because I know a number of you do, if you would, put the cash in an envelope and put your name on it. That way we can prepare tax statements for you, which, by the way, those will be ready before the end of the month. And that will allow us to keep track of how we're doing together as a church with our giving. When we think about it, human brains are quite simply amazing pattern recognition machines. Researchers tell us that we cannot think fast enough to logically analyze every situation in which we find ourselves. So we rely on our ability and our ability to recognize and interpret patterns to figure out what to do. Let me tell you a quick story. This summer, the staff and I did an outreach down in Carytown. And we took some things with us on this site. We took the bags that we were giving away. They're reusable bags. We were at the farmer's market. And then we took our A-frame signs that tell you where things are, where you're trying to park, and we replaced all of them. We have three or four with these signs that said we're giving away free bags. So I just want you to imagine me standing in front of the Carytown Farmer's Market, one of the entrances. I'm standing next to an A-frame sign that says free bags on both sides, and I'm holding said free bags, all right? So keep that picture in your mind. Now, as we were handing out the outreach, the thing I would say immediately to a person coming up, would you like a free, emphasis on the word, free reusable bag? And before I could even get it out of my mouth, many people were like, no, thanks. Right, Adam already pantomimed it. He was like, nope. And they would just walk past me. And then it was sort of interesting because they would buy something at the farmer's market, not have a bag, load it up with the stuff, and come back and say, I probably should have listened to what you were saying and taken one of your bags. I go, oh, no, they're still free. Here you are. And what I think was happening right there is we have this ability to see different types of patterns. And then we transform these patterns into concrete, actionable steps. And maybe in this case, the folks that I was encountering on that day, they thought maybe I was panhandling, right? That it was like a little scheme. I say free, but in fact, you've got to pay for it. So they were already ready with their no thanks. But consider a toddler learning to read. Reading for this toddler starts with recognizing a single letter. T or A or B. Then the grouping of these letters into what we call words. Then it's the grouping of these words into sentences or into a series, what we might call a sentence. Then it's a series of sentences, what we might call a paragraph. Then it's a series of paragraphs, what we might call a chapter. And then it's chapters forming what we call books. And it goes on and on. And then you find yourself screaming at your 7-year-old because she can't put down the book as you're trying to leave the house to get her to an appointment. My former employer, IBM, built a machine learning device called Watson. Basically, what researchers discovered as they studied the brain, the human brain, was the human brain's ability to recognize patterns. So they realized that they could teach a computer all of the patterns of a chessboard, and that as the computer learned all of the possible patterns, the computer became intelligent enough that it could start to beat grandmasters at chess. Now, Watson has gone on to expand beyond chess. It's actually played at Jeopardy and beat humans at playing Jeopardy. And now they've put Watson into practice with helping doctors help with their diagnoses when you come in for health-related issues. But even though Watson seems to be moving at that fun pace, there's still hope for us humans, especially for us who are experts at pattern recognition. Take quarterbacks, for instance. Now, I know a lot of you know I'm a really huge sports fan, and every sermon, every week has some sports analogy in it. And I know you just get overwhelmed with it, especially when I wear my jerseys on Sunday morning. But just stay with me for one more sports analogy, all right? Take quarterbacks. For those of you who are new, I never talk about sports. I talk about computers more than sports. Quarterbacks have the football in their possession in a typical game for 90 seconds. 90 seconds. Think about that. Successful quarterbacks complete 7 out of every 10 possession that they have of the ball. How do they do it? Pattern recognition. They are some of the best pattern recognizers in the world, especially given the pressure that they find themselves in. They're standing on a field with a 300-pound lineman heading towards them with a single goal, which is to liberate the football that they have in their possession. So most quarterbacks have about 2 seconds to make a decision before they throw the ball. And many of them do this in nanoseconds. And they're able to do it by efficiently recognizing the pattern that's coming at them. In one sense, friends, they react to the patterns they observe. In the story of the first humans who were planted in a garden, it's found in Genesis. If you have a Bible, your Bible app, or you got one off of the Bible cart, we're going to be in Genesis chapter 3 for a moment. And Genesis is the first book. It's all the way to the left. And chapter 3 is usually like on page 2 or 3. Mine, it's 5. In the story of the first humans who were planted in a garden, we see something that unfolds here. After these humans take what doesn't belong to them, they unleash into God's good creation evil, sin, and death. They unleash it into the world. And God expels them from the garden because of this action, but not before he makes them a promise. The promise was effectively this: I will fix the results of your rebellion, the sin, the death, and the evil that you've unleashed. Trust me, God says, as I lead you into life. I'm going to read from Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. This is the Lord speaking to the serpent, representing the evil that was unleashed. And he says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. And Bible scholars and researchers have helped us understand that what we see in this passage is God is foretelling what he's going to do through humanity by bringing forth his son Jesus much, much, much later in the story to bring about restoration to what's been broken in the story. But here's the thing. Before God can accomplish what he wants in our lives, we have to do something, or rather, we have to be willing to do something, which is break our solidarity with the powers that the first humans unleashed, the powers of sin, the powers of death, and the powers of evil, and trust that God has the keys to life. I think this is why Jesus says, now over to the right, we're going to go to Matthew, the first book of the New Testament, and I'm going to be in Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. And I think this is why Jesus says in Matthew 16, 24, whoever wants to be my disciple must first deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. See, basically what Jesus is saying here is that in order for us to live, we have to first die. You know, there's even a song lyric about this. It's called Everyone Wants to Go to Heaven. And the next part of the song lyric, which should be on the screen, is, but no one wants to die. And I think in one sense, it's true. We want the benefits without the sacrifice, without the cost to receive it. You know, I wonder if we, since we are humans who have these brains that are good at recognizing patterns, I wonder if we are able to recognize the patterns of how God operates in our lives. Are we able to quickly discover what God wants to do and what he wants to accomplish as he gives us life, partnering with us to help us break our solidarity with the powers of sin and evil and death, what we might call the results of that rebellion, so that we might be transformed into God's image bearers and his disciples? Or do we instead allow the patterns of sin and evil and death to prevent us from seeing what God is willing to do in us and with us and through us in partnership? Over the next several weeks, what I want to do is I want to take a look at some key biblical characters. Traditionally, we call them heroes, but I want to de-emphasize that because they do some things that are not heroic. I mean, they do some things that are heroic, but a lot of it's not that heroic. So I don't want to call them heroes. I'm just going to call them characters, if that's okay. And I want to examine how God repeats the promise of life that he made to the first humans. I will fix the results of the rebellion and help you break your solidarity with the powers of sin, death, and evil. But first, I need you to trust me as I lead you into life. And so we're calling this series The Promises of God. And as we get started, what I want to do is this week and next week, I want to start with one of the first characters that we see in Scripture, a dude named Abram. In the story of Abram, he's a wandering warlord. He's a nomadic warlord. He's a son of Ur. He's a pantheistic moon worshiper. It just means that they had lots of God as opposed to a monotheist, which means one God. He was without an heir. And as we turn back to Genesis, to the left, all the way to the beginning, Genesis chapter 12 this time. But if you have your Bible app, you can go a lot faster than I. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 3, Abram has this strange interaction with an unproven God, a God who doesn't even take time to introduce himself, a God who opens up with a demand: leave everything you know behind and follow me. I'm going to take you somewhere, God says to Abram. In short, we could categorize these first several verses in Genesis chapter 12 as God saying, I will bless you to be a blessing. But let's go ahead and take a look at it and read in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 3. The Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, from your people, from your father's household to the land that I will show you. And let me just say, just for a moment, we don't have a lot of context for this because a lot of us probably don't live where we grew up. I certainly don't currently live where I grew up. I grew up in the inner city of Washington, D.C. in Anacostia. And now I'm here in Michigan. And if you would have told me as a high schooler that I was going to live in Michigan and probably die in Michigan, I would be like, what? What? Where is Michigan? Right? I just didn't have a sense of it. I'm one of those people who was the coast, right? The East Coast and the West Coast. And there were these states that you flew over to get to one or the other. And wasn't Michigan somewhere in there, you know, that kind of thing? But now I'm a Michigander. And I say that. And people say I have a bit of an accent, which I'm not sure if it's my D.C. accent or my Midwestern one or whatever. But I love it here. And I even love the snow. Like, I mean, how do you come from a place where it doesn't snow so much to a place that it snows? We have the second worst winters in the entire country. And now I can say from the stage with integrity that I'm starting to, like, love it, right? Okay. God is able to do miraculous things, friends. I mean, he really is. He can transform me into someone who loves the snow. My wife's like, really? You don't like shoveling it? I'm like, but that's different. That's different. That's moving snow from one place to another. Where is the fun in that, right? Who wants to do that? Let's go back to the Word of God. Verse 2. God says to Abram, I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all of the people will be blessed through you. And as you read closely, you'll see that it's not just a promise. It's, in fact, a sevenfold promise. So I actually reformatted it and put it on the screen so that you could see and count the seven promises that God makes just in his opening interaction with Abram. While you're considering that, consider this question. Would you willingly give up everything that you knew, everything that you understood, everything that you expected in life, and abandoned it? And abandoned it to follow a strange, unproven God who doesn't introduce himself. Sit with that question. Would you leave everything behind to follow this God? No, he didn't. He just showed up, Debbie, and he just said, I'm going to make you great. That was it. He didn't say, I'm the God of beginning and end. I'm the God who set up the heavens. I'm the God who counts the hairs on your head. He says all of that later. Right here, he just literally shows up and says, leave everything behind and come and follow me. As you consider that question, think through what you now know about God, or what you've been told about God, or what you've read about God's character in Scripture. Think about the promises that God has made in Scripture. Now consider whether you believe that the God that's revealed in Scripture can be trusted. Before we move on, and I don't really, this isn't for me in one sense, because you could answer me, oh yeah, of course. Because who wants to sit in church and say, no, not really? I mean, like, sometimes, like, is what he's asking for my benefit? Then yes, of course I trust him. But if he's asking me to give up something, if he's asking me to sacrifice something, if he's asking me to serve someone, then, well, I mean, can I get a second opinion? Like, is there a check that I can do here? Like, you say it's here, but what does the original Hebrew say, or the original Greek? And I know they spoke Aramaic, so maybe there's some words that's lost in translation, right? This, friends, really isn't about you answering me. It's really about where you find yourself. As you look in Scripture, as you think about who God has been revealed, is God the one that has been revealed in Scripture, the character of whom we've studied and we're here today to learn about, are you willing to trust that God? Here are some of the promises that God makes to us as you consider. If you've been around the church for the past 6 months, you may remember that I've been working through a metaphor. And I'm borrowing from the metaphor woman, Anna, because she, every sermon, there's a metaphor. So I'm just trying to be like Anna and bring up my own metaphors. And it has to do with seeds, the soil, and the harvest. And I really like this metaphor. I've been talking to my pastoral advisor about it every week we meet, and usually every week I have some reference to the metaphor, and so he and I sit, and we just go back and forth over it, and I'm waiting for him to say, all right, just let it go, all right? You've just exhausted the power of it. But so far, I still have a little bit of space here. So here's why I like the metaphor of the seeds, the soil, and the harvest. I think that God wants to transform us into image bearers, into disciples who trust and obey God, as God leads us from death into life. And this is why I think the seed metaphor is helpful, because a seed consists of three basic parts. It's way more than that, and I'm not an expert, okay? So I just read, okay, because I can read, I figured out the pattern recognition and then translated it. But here are the three parts, because someone's going to tell me, oh, you missed this and that, and that's good, and we can add it later. The three basic parts of a seed: there's a protective coat, there's a food supply, and inside the food supply is a dormant plant embryo. Now, on the internet, because I'm not a graphic designer, though, if there are any of you in the church, talk to me, because we need some help. I couldn't find like one of those cross sections that wasn't like clip-arty lame, and it was just jarring, and I have some taste, and so I didn't want to put it up. So you can see in this that the plant embryo is sort of coming out. So usually we would just get a cross-section and see the dormant life that's inside. So just bear with me as you critique my image, okay? When a seed is planted in nutrient-rich soil, the dormant embryo that's within the seed can awaken. It awakens to germinate, and with sunlight and rain, the seed can grow into a mature plant, which ultimately can lead to a harvest. When we look at Scripture, when we look at God's interaction with some of the characters in Scripture, we see a pattern that emerges as God repeats that same basic promise. I will fix the results of the rebellion. Will you trust me as I lead you into life? God asks this question over and over again to varying people with different results. And within these three stories, there's this pattern that I see that emerges. And I just want to share it with you. The pattern goes a little bit like this. God makes a promise to somebody. The promise receiver, or the receiver in this case, has to decide. And I just pause with me for a moment on the decision. Because the receiver has to decide to believe both the promise and the promise giver. Because it doesn't work to believe the promise if you don't believe the person who's making the promise, right? Because they're not going to come through, right? Have you been disappointed? Someone promised you something, a boss, hey, I'm going to give you that raise, and then they didn't. A friend, hey, I'm going to help you in this way, and then they didn't show up, right? You can believe the promise, but if you don't also simultaneously believe the promise giver, you have a problem. So what I see in the pattern is that God makes the promise, but the receiver has to make a decision. Yes, I'm willing to receive the promise, but I also have to be willing to receive you, the promise giver. And then there's a period of waiting. And as we look in Scripture, and as we will over the next several weeks, we're going to see that often the waiting includes some pain, some suffering, and even a loss of reputation before the promise, or the receiver rather, is able to receive the promise. And then when the promise comes, there's the blessing of God. So just hold that like in your mind over the next several weeks, because that's going to be a pattern that I'm going to try to unfold for you as we walk through some of the stories of the characters in Scripture. See, when we wait for God and his promises to be fulfilled in our lives, it's sort of like that dormant seed. So see, now I'm bringing it back together. You were like, oh, wait, why did he talk about the seed? And now he's talking about the promise. Oh, he's going to make that metaphor work. I mean, he is riding that metaphor into life. All right, here we go. So the promise is like the dormant seed. The soil is like our lives. Now, here's the rub. What kind of seed is being planted in our lives? How are we cultivating the dormant seeds of life that God has planted within us? And then the fulfillment of the promise is like that mature plant, that plant embryo that breaks out and comes to life. Now, the reason why I like this metaphor of the seeds is because it asks us to do something, which is to look inward to see what God has seeded already within us. It's also helpful because a seed, now stay with me, a seed only gets one chance to get it right. There's a lot riding on the seed's ability to bring forth life. Now, before you leave church this morning, man, oh man, I was condemned by that word that I only get one chance. Just one chance to get it right. Just Hold it for a moment. Because what I want to say is this. We only come to life in partnership with God. That's where we find our true life, our true purpose, our true meaning. It's in partnership with God. So there's no condemnation here. There's an invitation instead. You know, Jesus says this really odd thing right before he dies in John chapter 12. This is to the right. It's in the Gospels. It's the last of the four Gospels. It's chapter 12, verse 23. Jesus says, the Son, he's talking to his disciples and he's predicting his death. He says, the hour has come from the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. He goes on in verse 25 and says, for those who love their life will lose it, while those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me, verse 26, must follow me, and where I am, my servant will also be there. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now, this is a very odd thing that he says here, but I love it because he's helping, I can see my seed metaphor working, right? Because effectively what he's saying is that kernel has to shed its protective coat in order for the dormant life that's within the seed to come forth. And when a seed becomes a plant, often plants can reproduce themselves. So that's what he's getting at. If you just let it fall to the ground and it stays in its protective coating, it's just a seed. But when it sheds the coating, when it dies, it comes to life. And then it can produce even more seed. I'm like, man, Jesus, you got my metaphor. I really appreciate the assist that I'm getting from you in the Word about this metaphor with the seeds. I'm glad you guys are laughing because I'm going to be talking about this all year long. I swear to you. I mean, well, I will take that back. I don't want to swear because then I want to break my swears. Look, this all got me thinking. God wants to do something within us that's significant. He wants to bring us to life, friend. God wants to break our solidarity, our partnership, our willing participation in sin, death, and evil. But we cannot do this on our own. We need God's help. So as we follow the unfolding stories of Abram and Joseph and David and Esther and Ruth and Jesus and Mary and Peter, I'm not doing all of them, it's only 6 weeks before Lent, but as we get through some of their stories, there is a period of receiving the promise, believing the promise and the promise giver, waiting on the promise before it comes forth. And we'll see that in order for us to come to life, we'll have to shed our protective coat so that the dormant life that God has placed within us can come alive. So here's my practical tip for us this morning. The band can slowly make their way back. I have quite a bit of this practical tip, but you can slowly make your way back. The first thing that we have to do as we receive the promise is figure out how to cultivate the soil. Sometimes the earth has this sort of protective crust on it, which can sort of be like our hearts. Our hearts can be hard. And so it doesn't make for fertile ground for seeds to be planted in. See, if you can work with me, I think that in order for us to receive the promise, we have to be in a place where we are cultivating nutrient-rich soil in our lives. And this starts with something that we've already been given, which is faith. Romans chapter 12, further to the right from John, used to remember, like, you know, all of the epistles, like General Electric Power Company for Galatians, Ephesians, you know, got it, Philippians, Colossians. You didn't do those mnemonics? Those were mine. So we're in Romans, which is just to the right of Acts. Romans chapter 12, verse 3, Paul says this, "For by the grace given to me, I say to every one of you," I think you all qualify, "do not think of yourself more highly than you ought." Oh, sorry. Should have just skipped to the part I wanted. But that might be helpful for us to hear, right? "Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment," Paul writes, "in according with the faith God has distributed to each of you." Paul implies that God has distributed faith to each of us. We already have it. Isn't that helpful? We already have it. So the question now is, how are you activating the faith that you already have in your life? In order to receive the promise of this unknown, unfamiliar, foreign God, Abram had to believe and accept as true that the promise was real and that the promise giver had the authority to come through on the promise that was made. So Abram had to trust the promise giver. Abram had to enter into a relationship with this new God. Abram had to trust that what he was being told was going to come about in his life. He had to risk everything in order to take possession of the promise. He had to give up everything that he knew, he understood, and trust so that he could risk and receive the promise of this new unproven God. So my question is, how are you cultivating the soul of your life? How are you feeding it? How are you tilling it? How are you spending time creating space for God to speak life to you? What are you feeding the soil of your life? And how are you cultivating faith? We have this fun book. It's a book of spiritual practices. It's like about 2 inches thick, it's blue, and Anna had a copy of it on her desk this morning, and I needed a practical tip to sort of move us to the next step. And this is the one that Anna came up with, and I agreed, so I'm going to claim it, is here's the practice that we want you to do this week and into the next several weeks. And we may just stay in this practical tip or this spiritual discipline and then just ask you to try new things. It's called practicing the presence of God. And this is, the simple definition of it is this. Learn how to treat every moment as a gift from God. And when you master it, let me know, and I will do whatever you tell me to do, because you will have achieved all that there is to achieve in life, right? This is an ongoing process for us. Figuring out how, like when your spouse does something you don't approve of, to treat every moment as a gift of God. When you are frustrated, when you're rushing and you get stopped by the lights, when your research fails in the way that you've planned it to come out one way and it comes out another way, when you write that program and it causes a memory crash and crashes your whole computer, treating every moment as a gift from God. When that customer is berating you as you serve them their coffee, you treat every moment as a gift from God. Have I covered everybody in the room? I try to, you know, sort of go pretty much everywhere. And as we increase our awareness of God in our everyday, this does something. It allows us to become aligned with God as we look for, enjoy, and experience God's presence in our lives. Friends, we won't have faith in God and the promises that he offers until we believe that God is active and actively working for our good. Amen? All right. We're going to have some fun in this series. I can just feel it. You know how you just get started with certain things and you just have a sense that God is there. I mean, maybe you won't. I will. Prayer sense for this morning. For those of you who are at the end of your rope, you're out of hope, God wants to bring you new life. And here's, again, this is another one of these, like, beautiful tie-ins. The prayer, the people who are praying and asking God on your behalf before the celebration, we don't collaborate. So they don't know what I'm always going to say in my sermons. And it's as if God is actually speaking to us. God wants to bring new life. And the next image was, it was the image of roots having been cut off, and that what God wanted to do was to activate a period of new growth. Amen? So if that's you, or you're here today and you're in pain in any form or shape, emotional, physical, or spiritual, we'd love to pray for you. We have trained prayer ministers who will come alongside of you and will bless what God is at work doing. Sean's going to lead us now in our act of worship with our giving, and then Danielle Reynolds is going to come and lead us in communion, and I am so delighted to have Danielle come to the stage. Danielle is on our pastor's advisory team. She's a native of the South Atlanta metro area, and she spends her time here in Ann Arbor working with coaching and encouraging undergraduates at the University of Michigan. So if you don't know Danielle, you need to meet her because she's a fantastic human being. Sean?
All right. Well, thank you, Pastor Donnell, and thanks to all y'all for being here. We're going to take our offering in just a minute with some details before we do. In the seat back in the pocket in front of you, the back of the seat, there's some cards, a welcome card, a prayer card, and a giving card. So grab those, and you're going to start filling them out. If you're relatively new here, please fill the welcome card out. We'd love to get to know you. And you can also fill out the prayer card. As a staff, we meet on Wednesdays, and we go through those cards and pray for every one of them. And those help us with that, obviously. So you can keep filling those cards out while I keep talking, and then drop them in the offering bag as it goes by in just a moment. And finally, if you'd like to partner with us financially to help bring some more Jesus to our community, please do. We rely on all the offerings given today to keep the ministries running and the lights on in the building, and they're all greatly appreciated. You can drop cash or checks into the offering bags. If you'd like to use a debit or credit card instead, we have a giving kiosk out in the lobby, or you can go to our website, annarborvineyard.org, and click on the Give tab at the top of the homepage. So I'll give you just a couple moments to finish filling out those cards. And we'll pray now. Let's pray for the offering. Father, we love you, we adore you, and we trust you, God. And I pray that you would give us grace to trust you more and more, and in deeper ways, in new ways, God. We pray that you would use these gifts to let the hungry be fed, the lonely be comforted, to bless those in need. And we pray that you would be greatly trusted and praised as we give. We ask all this in your name. Amen. So we'll take our offering now, and we'll stay seated while we do it, and let's sing the doxology together.
Praise God from the moon, all bless.
That you could be here with us this morning. We'd like to especially offer a warm welcome to anyone who might be visiting with us today. Our communion table is open to all, and we extend an invitation to each of you to join us as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. Our communion meal comes served as a cup inside of a cup, with the bread of life in the bottom cup and the fruit of the vine in the top cup. If you require a gluten-free option, that is available to my right. Just be sure to ask your server for it. Let's all stand for communion. Jesus, we come to this meal in the knowledge that we require your sustenance in order to wait. Trusting in your goodness and your love, for the fullness of your promises. At this family table, we find the strength and the patience to hold fast to the words you have spoken to us. You give us our daily bread, our ability to endure. We pray with the words of Ephesians 3:16-21, that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen us with power through his Spirit in our inner beings, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And we pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray the words he has taught us. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'll come to communion in two rows down the aisle.
Let us adore him.
Draw me gently to my knees and I am lost for a soul, lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. At the cross you look at me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for a soul, lost in love. I am sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
A reading from Ephesians. I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and how high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen.
Amen. Have a great week.